matter who you are
or where you are on life's journey.
You are welcome here by the five of us
and the six communities we represent.
No matter how long it's been,
no matter how far you've wandered,
no matter what you've done or what you think you might have done wrong,
you are welcomed here.
Here, your past is forgotten.
You're your mistakes are forgiven.
Here, differences are accepted. Wounds are healed.
Brokenness is mended.
So you can be being loud and proud.
Or reserved and unperturbed.
Just so you know, you are welcome.
So welcome.
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 Welcome. Welcome.
A family friend composed this lovely essay reflecting on Beethoven's Sabbath and his own expectations of retirement. In it, he references a speech made by the composer Benjamin Britten about the holy triangle that, when fully operative, gives music an almost magical power. Composer, performer, and listener. Music requires more of an audience than merely hearing. It isn't a passive activity. There is work involved, skills to develop with practice, and failure to do this work and develop those skills robs music of its power to elevate. Well, much the same could be said about worship. There is a risk in worshiping over Zoom because it might lead you to assume that you are in a passive role, that nothing is required of you other than to have your screen on and staying muted. You know, these videos we put together, you know, they're pretty good, but they aren't Beethoven. This one, or even this one. For this to mean anything requires something of you, too. So, for our call to worship this morning, let's do a little work. Let's practice a skill that will make our hearts and minds more attuned to God's voice in our time together. Let's practice gratitude. So, toward that end, we're going to invite you to unmute yourself. And when this screen comes up, to give expression to your gratitude. Let's start by going back and thinking about our lives. Who are the people whose love brought out the best in you? When you have had something to celebrate, who did you want to celebrate it with? When you had struggle and sorrow, who did you look to for comfort? These people were not put into your life by accident. They are gifts. Let's say their names with gratitude. Speaking of gifts, how about this creation? What of our earth's many provisions have you tasted or touched, seen or heard that deserves a shout out? How about this air you take in with each breath? Or that show autumn put on for us? What creatures, what locations, what foods bring you delight? These things were not put into your life by accident. They are gifts. Let's name them with gratitude. Now, a lot of people are sick right now, And while that is cause for concern, cause for gratitude are all those devoted to getting us to the other side of all this. From doctors and nurses to long-haul truckers and mail carriers, from laboratory scientists to test subjects, police officers to school teachers, there are people who take great risks just by doing their job. You may or you may not know them by name, but they were not put into your life by accident. They are gifts, and they deserve our gratitude. This is our call to worship, our invitation to engage in the triangular activity of worship. You in your corner, this recording in another, and our God at the point, the giver of every good gift, who is worthy of our gratitude and praise.
For the healing love you have offered to us, for for the patience you have with us, for your presence that will never fail. We give you thanks, O Lord. This time of the year calls us to be ever mindful of the many blessings you have bestowed upon us. Remind us that we too should be a blessing as well. As we worship this morning, may our hearts and our spirits be open to you, that we may grow in our faith and service. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy upon us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. When Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they?" Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well."
The other day, I saw an obituary for the last of my 3 Girl Scout troop leaders. These ladies devoted countless hours to planning our weekly after-school meetings that were always action-packed and fun, as well as educational. We worked on earning badges, volunteering in our community, and forged lifelong friendships with a vow to be a friend to all and a sister to every other Girl Scout. Although we were supposed to pay weekly dues, I don't think anyone was ever excluded due to family income. And even though not all of us could afford to buy the full uniform, we made do by wearing a long sleeve white blouse with our green sash of badges over it. The highlight of every year was our summer camping trip to Camp Kokowani, where we learned to appreciate the environment, to cook over open fires, and to sing songs together before retiring to our tents. As I read her obit, I reflected on the amount of time and energy that she and the other leaders put into planning our activities and supervising us. I'm sure that when we returned home, exhausted and smelling like campfire smoke, not all of us remembered to express our gratitude as we unloaded our gear, headed home for hot baths, and looked forward to sleeping in our own beds. So when I reread this week's gospel story of Jesus and the 10 lepers, I did not focus on judging the 9 for their lack of good manners. Instead, it seems more important to see how God comes to us in our suffering, whatever form that suffering might take. For our ancestors, suffering could come in the form of leprosy, a highly contagious but little understood disease. Jewish law in Leviticus chapter 13, verses 45 and 46 states that, quote, "Anyone with such a defiling disease must wear torn clothes, let their hair be unkempt, cover the lower part of their face, and cry out, 'Unclean, unclean.' And as long as they have the disease, they remain unclean. They must live alone. They must live outside the camp, end quote. In other words, people with leprosy were shunned. They were isolated. They were made invisible. This is reflected in their biblical name, the lepers. We don't know if all of them were men, if they were all adults or teens or children. We don't know how long they'd been there, what their previous lives consisted of, who they were as human beings. They were just labeled by society for their disease. And how does Jesus help them? Well, unlike some other stories of healing, Jesus doesn't touch them, but even still at a distance, it says, he sees them. He sees them as people, as children of God, as brothers and sisters. He really sees them through the eyes of love. And they were healed. And then because at that time, the priests were the only ones who could officially pronounce that someone was either clean or unclean, he tells them to go to their priests to complete their return to society. I think this story may be especially meaningful now when our world is trying to cope with a pandemic that not only brings physical pain, but also emotional isolation from our loved ones. A few days ago, when the area UCC pastors met via Zoom, one of the ministers from the Indianapolis area shared that members of her congregation who have tested positive for the COVID-19 virus have called the church to let her know, but they've asked her not to tell anyone else. And she's concluded that for some people, there seems to be some sense of shame associated with having this disease. Nonetheless, respecting people's privacy, she's still urging her members to share their diagnosis so that people may comfort and pray for one another, even if it is remotely. So whether it's leprosy or COVID-19, we need God's comforting presence in our lives. And as brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, we need to support one another, especially now. Besides illustrating God's presence in our suffering and God's concern for our healing, this narrative also makes it plain that God isn't finished with all of us just yet. Achieving wholeness seems to be a process that each person works out with God's help, and we're not all in the same place. Only the Samaritan, who is a double outsider, first of all because of his nationality, and secondly because of his disease. Only the Samaritan has the spiritual maturity, not only to accept God's healing, but also to acknowledge with humility and gratitude all that God has done in his life. Likewise, we need to recognize that it's not just we who are living our lives working alone, but it's God working through us to help create a more loving and sane world, a place where it's never too late to express our gratitude to one another. So let me say thank you to all my Girl Scout leaders and my mentors over the years. And thanks to our Creator. Thank you, God, for the many blessings in my life. Now, this is a Thanksgiving season like no other, and maybe some of us are finding it difficult to feel blessed without our usual gatherings of family and friends. But remember, God has faith in us, in creation, and the healing of this broken world will continue as we work towards our redemption and ultimately our salvation. Let us hold on to our faith, remembering God's promises, trusting in a better tomorrow, and giving God the glory with grateful hearts. Amen.
Now come, eat this bread of life if you are hungry for justice.
Come, drink from the cup of life if you are thirsty for goodness.
Come to this sheltering place of our welcoming God if you've ever faced rejection or harm.
Come to this resting place of our comforting Christ if you've suffered sorrow or grief.
Come to God's own home and be welcomed with hospitality. Come to the table of plenty and be filled with Christ's own abundance.
It is right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times, in all places, give thanks and praise to you, the Most High God, for your acts of mercy and justice.
By your appointment, the seasons come and go. You bring forth bread from the ground and create the fruit of the vine.
You have made us in your image to love and be loved. And you have bid us to care gently and diligently for the world.
Even when we have abused your creation and turned aside from your ways, you have been slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love.
You are holy indeed, O God of majesty, and blessed is your beloved child, Jesus Christ.
Born to reign in David's line, Jesus lived with the lowly and cared for the least of your children. His power was revealed in weakness, his majesty witnessed mercy.
Jesus's executioners knelt before him in ridicule, giving him bruises instead of praise, and piercing thorns for a crown. His only earthly throne was a cross to die on. And even there, his arms stretched out in love to embrace both friends and foes alike.
From the grave, you raised Jesus to your right hand, where even now he rules from heaven and commands true loyalty from peoples and nations.
Jesus will come again in glory to judge the world. Those who have cared for the needs of the least will be welcomed into his promised reign of peace.
On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you, he broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, so that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by Christ's blood.
By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet.
Through him, with him, and in him, in unity with the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen.
Because there is one loaf, many as we are one body. For it is of one loaf of which we all partake. When we break the bread, it is a means of sharing in the body of Christ. When we give thanks over the cup of wine, it is a means of sharing in the blood of Christ. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take, eat, drink, and be thankful.
Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet in your eternal realm. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work and praise your glory for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Too often, the offering is viewed as a time to pay the bills. Today, many see the offering as a way for the church just to collect money to pay bills and maybe fund a ministry here or there. Yet at its very core, the offering is so much more. The offering is the time we are invited to proclaim through faith that we love God first. We love God more than our jobs, our assets, our possessions, our hobbies, and even our families. The offering is the time we proclaim our trust in God above all else as we move into an unknown future. It is in giving we stay connected to what is really important in life, and not allow materialism to define who we are. And it is in giving that we gain a deeper understanding of the depth of sacrificial love, a love that God has for us. It is in giving that we grow in our own personal journey as a follower of Jesus. It is in giving we say to God and to the world those simple yet life-defining words, "I love you first, and I will love you always." Thank you for giving today.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command and all the stars obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with food. He formed the creatures with his word and then pronounced them good. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed where'er I turn my eye.
If I survey the ground or gaze upon the sky, there's not a plant or flower below but makes thy glories known. And clouds arise and tempests flow by order from thy throne. While all that borrows light from thee is ever in thy care, and everywhere that man can be, thou God art present there. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today. We are so pleased to be able to serve you through these Zoom church services. And most of all, it is a gift to us to continue on this journey with you. May you and all you love have a lovely Thanksgiving.
Now, may the goodness and steadfast love of the Lord be known to you this week. When you are tempted to allow your days to be defined by the things that would lead you to stray from your Maker, may the one who has brought you to redemption also redeem your troubled days. May any wandering in your life only serve to remind you that our God of peace and hope is constantly in pursuit of you, and this divine love endures forever. May the God who always welcomes us home reveal to you the countless reasons we have to be thankful to our Creator. May this lead those who are currently feeling lost to return back towards home. This week, as we experience Thanksgiving with mixed emotions, may you take time to recall past blessings as a reminder that God's comforting goodness is never in short supply. May your soul find true satisfaction in its holy source, for all good things find their beginnings with God. May you have a blessed Thanksgiving. Amen.
Around us. so for tonight.